If we look at all these skills, one way or the other, they are helping us become better Muslims as well. Like metacognition is like that taqwa that we have inside us, that we are keeping a close watch on ourselves. Task initiation is so much important for us, for our ibadah. Quran samne padha hua hai, baithe mein padhti hoon, padhti hoon, padhti hoon, abhi padhti hoon. This is lack of task initiation. Time management, we often talk about that. Prioritization is so much important. You have to analyze in any given situation whether this is farz or nafal. And what do I pick first? What do I do first? Sometimes we are spending so much time, we are exhausting our energies in one area, and that is not even farz. Response inhibition tells us that we need to be very careful about our deeds. We shouldn't be getting indulged in sins. Just this one click will take me towards a sin. Just this one word I utter will be a backbiting. It will be registered for me. So I have to develop response inhibition. So what you are actually doing is, when you're working on these skills for children in your classroom environment, you're not just doing a technical job that you are improving their academics. You are bringing out the best capacities the kids have to be good Muslims, to be more practicing Muslims. And this is the problem. On the lip service, you talk to your children, they know everything. What they're lacking is these skills. They're not able to manage themselves. They're not able to perform these skills. So the first ones to develop are the response inhibition, working memory. We need working memory when we're praying. We need working memory. Somebody has just given us an instruction. You're going out with your friends. Make sure you don't do something haram. Azan abhi hone wali hai, namaz padh lena. Kid goes and they forget. The working memory is like that echo in our mind constantly. This is what I'm supposed to perform. Somebody has given you an important task to do and you remember. You remember your tasbihat and your duas. Emotional control, we always need it. Our deen is about the accountability of our emotions, the right application of the emotion, the right situation, and then sustain attention. In the preschool to elementary classes, they start developing task initiation, organization, time management, and goal directed persistence. You will get a variety of graphs in which you'll find out how these executive skills are developing. So you have to like gradually build them up, and they start getting their peak at 6 to 8 years of age. There are other ways of dividing these executive skills. One involves your cognition, thinking, and one involves your behavior, like working memory, planning, prioritization, organization, time management, and metacognition. Basically involve your thinking process, your paradigms. If you're working on your paradigms, you're working on your thinking process, you're able to organize many things. Jab aap overwhelmed ho jate hain kisi cheez se, all you have to do is sit down and just organize things in your head. The more organized you are in your head, you're able to actually plan out and lay it out on the paper as well. And the doing things are response inhibition, emotional control, sustained attention, task initiation, goal-directed persistence, and also develop flexibility. When I was learning these executive skills with a couple of psychologists, so we discussed these parameters. The response inhibition develops first, then comes in the working memory. For some kids, emotional control will be there from the very beginning. You will find out some kids are very difficult from the birth. They excessively cry, they're too cranky, and you find out they have a very difficult temperament from the very beginning. And you're like, ye mera ek bachcha toh bahut achcha hai, ye dusra kyun aisa hai? So probably one of them, in their frontal lobe, Allah has given them the capacity for the emotional control. To the other, doesn't have it, but you have to work and develop it. Many mothers, they come to me when the kids are toddlers for their tantrums. That means the child doesn't have emotional control. So what you do is, you teach them emotional control rather than getting tied up in their tantrums. And then in the early childhood, you work on sustained attention and flexibility. In Hamare Bache department, when the children come to us for a weekly class, I have told my teachers to work on these parameters, whatever activity they are doing in the initial years. Because we have children coming from 1 year till 19 years. So from 1 year to 4 years, we constantly work on these initial. You have to teach them response inhibition. Like if the mother is praying, typically what the kids do, if they need something, lack of working memory, emotional control, response inhibition, they start crying for something. amma ko namaz nahi padne dete. So we teach them, when someone is praying, your mother is praying, and you need something, you need to wait rather than cry. And we actually demonstrate to them, you need something, you're hungry, you're tired, you're crying. We teach them, if you're tired, you don't cry. Tell your mom, I'm tired. And if you can't speak, have an action. Say, I'm tired, I want to sleep. Learn a dua and give out that dua. So these are the small parameters that you have to teach them. You know, you are actually teaching them life skills. If you're just going very technical in your education, you're not bringing out the best product for akhira. Then in the middle school, you teach them task initiation, planning and prioritization. Okay. That is why we have a time frame from 7 years to 10 years for salah. If they have developed emotional control, working memory, response inhibition, they have sustained attention, then all they have to do is learn to initiate themselves. Azan suni nahi to namaz ke liye uth gaye. This is what we want the kids to do. And later on, time management, organization, and ultimately, in the teens, they develop this metacognition. Let us try to see how the executive skills they develop in the brain. Frontal lobe is responsible for these executive skills. We have a variety of things happening over there. Let's try to see. Frontal lobe directs our behavior, helps us decide what we should pay attention to and what acts we should be doing. That's why we put our frontal lobe in sajda on the ground. I am nobody, Allah. Whatever capacity you have given me, I'm putting it in front of you. I'm submitting my frontal lobe to you. I'm submitting myself in sajda to you. Links our behavior together so that we can use past experience to guide our behavior and make future decisions. As an adult, that's what we're doing. We see from the past experiences what went wrong, what was I not able to do, and in the present we make decision and then we execute them in the future. It helps us control our emotions and behavior, taking into account external and internal constraints as we work towards the safety. We fine-tune according to our whatever the need and the feedback. So in initial years, you have to become your child's frontal lobe. They don't have that capacity. There are two phases when they're kids in the preschool. And second is the time when they enter their teenage. They say that there is a dip of those executive skills when the children are in their teenage. Because many a time the teachers as well as the parents, they get extremely upset with their children. Itna kuch humne inko sikhaya hai aur ab inka style change ho raha hai. My kid used to pray, stop praying. The student was so good in the studies, have become casual. Why? Because they have a dip in their executive skills at that time, and they again need a support structure from the teachers as well as from the parents to practice these skills. Now we come to a couple of questions. When your strength coincides with your student's weakness, because we also have executive skills. For example, if I have a strong executive skill, and when I enter the classroom environment, and it can happen to you as a parent at home as well, and your student or the child standing in front of you has a weakness of that executive skill, then what do? You can have agreement on giving help. For example, my time management, I have a strength of time management, and I see my students, I can see they're messed up about time. I can teach them because it is my strength. It comes so easy for me how to manage time and do multiple tasks. So whatever tips I am using, I can teach them. I'm able to give sustained attention to something, and I notice there is a student in my class who cannot have a sustained attention. Whatever tips I use for that attention, I can help teach them. I can be creative in that area because it is my strength. लेकिन होता ये है कि हम फ्रस्ट्रेट होके सिर्फ ये कहते हैं ये कोई मुश्किल काम तो नहीं है. मैं भी तो पढ़ती हूँ, मैं भी तो काम करती हूँ. Why can't you do it? ये भी तो करता है, ये भी तो करता है. How come they are able to do it? I have 20 plus children in my class. Everyone does it. There's only this one child, so there is nothing wrong with me and the way I'm teaching it. Everything is wrong with that child. Yes, there is something wrong with that child. Maybe he has not developed that skill. But the problem is, you have to become the frontal lobe for the child. You have to teach that child. Unless you teach, the child will not develop it. So you have to identify your weakness and your student's strength too. You have to do both things. You have to analyze what are my strong areas. And what are the areas which are not the strength of my student, and you can teach them. Similarly, you are going to have some weak areas. Some of your executive skills are going to be weak. So that becomes a challenge for me. I have to manage myself and also give opportunity to a student who is better than me in a certain executive skill. Another important area, when you and your students share same weakness, this is a big challenge. The teacher is not organized. She thinks she is. She's not. Her bag is messy, her table is messy, her work is messy. She doesn't have response inhibition. She keeps getting call from the principal repeatedly in the office and keeps getting warning. She doesn't care. She keeps doing the same thing. She keeps getting direction or complaint from a parent. Keeps going for a child ki ji hamare bacche ko mistreat kar rahi hai. Academic head keeps telling her, is tarah nahin karo, nahin karo. She doesn't listen. She is not able to manage the student with the response inhibition.
And even with the emotional control, sometimes teachers get frustrated with students.
Bilkul. The teacher has horrible emotional management, and the student also have it. This will happen with the mothers as well. The child is throwing tantrum and the mother is also shouting and screaming, and she is crying as well. What do I do with this kid? Work on it so you laugh about it rather than weep about it. Achha, aap bhi bhool gaye, aaj main bhi bhool gayi. I'm so sorry. Rather than covering up for yourself and giving hard time to the student. Oh, I'm so sorry. Jis tarah kabhi kabhi aap bhi pencil bhool jate, dekhe mujhe bhi mere bag mein se pencil nahi mil rahi. Because you are the role model. And then obviously you have to work on your skill as well. Then brainstorm solution to the common problems. Maybe when I'm upset, I stay quiet, I take a time out, and you also take a time out. You know, when you give me difficult time in class, I get very emotional. And I'm sure you also get emotional when you are not able to do something. Maybe we can decide something together about it. You can talk to your student or even child at home. You made it, child will also make it. Don't get frustrated. We all have some sort of executive skill weakness. We worked on it, like, we brought it just to the bare minimum. It's okay. Sometimes we are in panic mode, not for just our class students, especially for our own kids. Iska kya banega, ye kya karega, iska kya hoga. Tell yourself, if I did it, inshallah, we'll also do it. I'll make dua and I'll at least put in my right effort. Bas itna kaam maine karna hai. Take systematic approach for self and children. Another important thing we have to understand is when there is a wide gap. Under stress, our ability to cope deteriorates. Now we are sitting and we're discussing, and you might be able to empathize with many of your students and even yourself. I feel so bad for that student of mine. But since right now we are in a very settled, comfortable environment, it is easy to talk about it. But once you're in your classroom environment, and there are so many challenges, and each student have a different set of executive skills, and coming to you with a different package, it becomes difficult. When executive skills seem to suffer a setback, good clue that your stress level is rising. When you are stressed out and you are trying to problem solve in your classroom environment, you will get an anda, zero. No result. Hardly any result. And you'll feel like a failure. So the first thing you have to do is, if you're upset about something, first settle your own emotions. De-stress yourself one way or the other. Just do something or don't do something at that moment. Don't take any big decision. Even as a parent, if you are too touchy about something that is bothering you about your kid, you will not be able to problem solve. You have to de-stress yourself. Stress not good time to teach an executive skill to your child. You have to be actually enjoying doing that. And consistency is essential. We take a workshop, we get pumped up, we do it for like a week, and the graph then doesn't just go down, it has a big major dip. We do nothing at that moment. So you have to tell yourself, I have to be consistent. You need to have not just a planner for the academic performance, you need to have planner for all these students who are having these deficiencies. Since the time I have been learning about these executive skills and I'm teaching to my own volunteer staff, That's how we assess the children. Whenever we have problem in the class, I tell the coordinator and the teacher, apparently looks like this is the executive skill this child doesn't have, let's work on it. Stress, child feels cornered, expectations and criticism. The child is stressed out, that's all he sees. Doesn't see any skill that is being built inside him. Now, let's come to some solution. I'll give you 10 principles for improving your child's executive skills. There are specific measures that can be taken, and there are general measures that can be taken. So we'll be talking more about the general measures. The first thing that you have to do, understand, which I have told you already, is look at this picture. What do you see? We start teaching our children. We want them to be on a bicycle from a tricycle. Then we move on to a bicycle, and children take time. And then they grow up, they are on their own. They still need supervision for a while. This is a process that we have to follow. And remember, when they are in the teenage, from the tricycle to a cycle, they're very independent in that. And the kid comes to you and says, Amma, mujhe bachpan se cycle chala raha hu, so I don't need to learn how to drive a car. Give me the car keys and I can take the car. Would you do that? Kya karenge? Get him admitted in a driving school. They will have to learn the driving, and then once they pass the test, then you will hand them over. Because this is a major blunder by the teacher and the parent, because they assume that from very childhood we have been teaching our children everything. So when he is teenager, grown up child, to usko cycle chalana aata hai, to car to automatically chala lega. We forget that when they are in their teenage, the whole scenario changes. And we need another training period in which we teach them again how to apply those principles that they had learned from their childhood. Only then they are able to practice it.